The quest for Fire. It's not just a mediocre Iron Maiden song, nor merely the most appropriate casting of actor Ron Perlman. Who can overestimate the importance of fire? And how did early man discover it? And what did they think when they first saw it?
Ow! Heat was hot!
We may never know what the first thought was, but the second thought was probably something like, hey, now I can burn my neighbor and all his stuff. Yes, fire was the hot new way to crush your enemies, and man has spent much of his history learning how to harness this terrible weapon. But fire is the true essence of chaos, and when mistreated, it brings utter destruction on a titanic scale. So man must have learned not to play with fire. Or did he? Fire is the great cleanser and consumer. Forest fires dominate landscapes across the world, and firebombing constitutes some of the most frightening chapters of war history. Early man's campfires had grown to horrendous size and power, creating their own weather systems and self-perpetuating until everything around them was reduced to ashes. Hear now and wonder in terror at the Firestorm. But how did we get from a campfire to a world-altering inferno? Well, first we need to know how fire works and, for that matter, what fire actually is. The answer to the latter question is somewhat difficult to nail down, and you're likely to piss off at least a few people when you try to define fire. Even Webster's dictionary refers to fire as a phenomenon, and the easiest answer is that it's something like a chemical reaction. Or maybe it's a product of combustion. Or maybe it's plasma. Whatever it is, the important part is how it works and what it needs. Those needs are principally fuel and an oxidant. The oxidant's the easy part because it's normally just oxygen. The fuel can be almost anything if the temperature gets hot enough, but common examples are wood, charcoal, trees, and volatile chemicals like gasoline. When combustion occurs and oxidation happens rapidly, you get fire. And that fire will stick around for as long as there's fuel to burn and oxygen to oxidize with. Speaking of oxygen, the best way to turn a fire into a blaze is to feed it lots of air. Wind from a bellows or from the weather will stoke the flames and speed up that process of oxidation. In most cases, fire will burn up whatever fuel is available, be it firewood, your house, or the state of California, and then it stops. This can take a long time in the case of wildfires, or very quickly in the case of modern homes, which go up in a blistering 3 to 6 minutes with total destruction happening in just under an hour. But what happens when there's lots of fuel, like tons of fuel? We now have a decent working definition of fire, but what about storm? Well, the boring version is, a storm is any disturbed state of an environment or in an astronomical body's atmosphere, especially affecting its surface, and strongly implying severe weather. It may be marked by significant disruptions to normal conditions, such as strong wind. That's the important one. Wind is easy enough to define. It's just the mass movement of large amounts of gases. It occurs, at least in the case of storms, when atmospheric pressure differences cause air to move from high pressure areas to low pressure areas. When that pressure changes faster, it causes the air to move faster in turn, which creates the strong winds. Please note, these are brief, likely deficient definitions of fire and wind that are only meant to make the next bit easier to understand, so please go easy on me. It's 1894, and Hinckley, Minnesota is experiencing a very dry, hot summer. Hinckley is a burgeoning lumber town with a vibrant tree-chopping industry, and the axemen were hard at work massacring the pine forests of eastern Minnesota.
I'm a lumberjack and I'm okay. I sleep all night and I work all day.
Basic 1890s lumberjackery procedure goes like this. Chop down the tree, then when you're finished murdering Treebeard, give him a shave right then and there and leave all of that leafy, twiggy refuse behind. This is known as slash. And by the end of August 1894, all of that slash was nice and dry from the drought conditions. Some lumberjacks even decided to burn their slash. Great idea, guys! In no time, hundreds of little fires had broken out across the forest, so there's no real way blame can be placed on any one person. But eventually, all of those little fires had coalesced into one mighty inferno. The dried slash provided ample kindling to ignite the fuel, i.e. the forest itself. And with all that fuel to burn, the fire grew bigger, but more importantly, it grew hotter, hot enough to melt barrelfuls of nails into one solid chunk, and hot enough to heat enormous amounts of air. And when air gets hot, it rises, and when large amounts of air move, it creates wind. The superheated air rises above the fire, creating a pressure differential beneath that's filled by cooler air outside the fire. This cooler air stokes the flames like a bellows before being heated to buoyancy itself and rising, thereby sustaining the wind system. When this system perpetuates itself, you get a firestorm. The Great Hinckley Fire destroyed several small towns in northeast Minnesota and killed upwards of 418 people. The fire raged for 5 days, but it's likely that the firestorm itself went out much sooner. This is due to one of the only good things about firestorms, and that's their disinclination toward movement. Yes, the fire did spread, but the firestorm itself likely stopped when the main mass of fuel burnt up. Now, obviously, there have been many wildfires across history, but the Hinckley Fire had a unique intensity caused by the drought conditions to produce a firestorm. Most wildfires never burn quite so hot, which is arguably worse because they burn slower and move further. The Hinckley Fire only lasted 5 days, while the recent Australian wildfires lasted for almost a year, and fires in the Amazon rainforest have been going off and on for even longer. One last word on wildfires before we move on. There is another kind of firestorm that occurs when large amounts of fuel are burned at once, but this one has less to do with wind and more to do with clouds. During the Black Saturday bushfires of 2009, again, Australia saw weeks-long wildfires raging across Victoria in the southeast. Some of these blazes were large enough to create their own low-pressure areas just like at Hinckley, though instead of one big thermal column burning in place, the plume rose into the air and created pyrocumulonimbus clouds. Thanks to the moisture released from the burning vegetation, the poor people of Australia not only had wildfires to deal with, they had wildfires with their own lightning. That's right, as much as 100 kilometers ahead of the storms, lightning was arcing off of the pyro clouds and igniting more fires in the process. Fun fact, pyrocumulonimbus clouds can sometimes produce rain as well as lightning, which can put out the fires that caused the clouds in the first place. The year 1666, the town, London. Thomas Farriner is closing up his bakery on Pudding Lane when the unthinkable happens. Bakery fire. Tom and his family managed to escape from a window to the neighbor's house, but they did leave their maid behind and she perished in the flames. You gotta love the 17th century. But the fire is quickly getting out of hand, and Tom and his neighbors tried to put it out themselves, but the local constable reckons it's time to fight fire with explosives. That's right, 17th century firefighters in London would use black powder to destroy buildings and create fire breaks to prevent the spread of fires. This was because London was absolutely jam-packed in 1666, with 80,000 people stuffed into 700 acres of land, most of them living in wooden buildings. So essentially it was a bundle of sticks looking for a match, as any small fire would quickly turn into a big one if it was allowed to spread. So if a fire broke out and it looked like it might catch on, the London firefighters were there to blow it up. Now, this isn't to say that they wouldn't use conventional means if they thought they might work, but in Farriner's case, there was little hope of getting a water cart out in time to put out the fire. But it was too late. The fire had spread to the neighbors' houses, then to the warehouses nearby, and then to the stores on the riverfront. The firefighters were raring to blow stuff up, but Lord Mayor Thomas Bloodworth decided he didn't want to make that decision because there was no way of warning the property owners that all of their stores were about to be obliterated. This proved a costly mistake, and it allowed the fire to spread into the heart of London, fanned into a conflagration by the heavy eastern winds. The Great Fire of London had begun. Meanwhile, back at Pudding Lane, things were really heating up. The narrow streets and corridors made perfect breezeways for the bakery fire, and the winds whipped the flames into a raging firestorm before long. London had provided the perfect conditions for a firestorm, and it was a truly hellish blaze. Remember the 1100 degrees Celsius from the Hinckley Fire? Well, the London Fire beat it by 600 degrees. That's enough to melt titanium, and enough to boil brass. The London fire was incredibly destructive, but surprisingly few deaths were reported. Between 4 and 8 were recorded at the time, but historians speculate that this number is too low because the death toll amongst the poor was often greatly underreported. What isn't disputed is the immense destruction left behind in the wake of the fire. 13,500 homes were destroyed, and 70,000 of the city's 80,000 residents were displaced. The monetary cost of the damage would be something like £1.7 billion in today's money. In 1940, Nazi Germany began an extensive bombing campaign over Great Britain. During the course of these raids, known as the Blitz, over 40,000 British civilians were killed and 2 million homes were destroyed. Some of these bombs managed to cause fires, the greatest of which occurring in London in late December. This fire raged for 10 hours and killed 160 people. It was called the Second Great Fire of London, and it was started with an incendiary bomb. Just 3 years later, the tables had turned, and the RAF and the US Army Air Forces were flying extended bombing raids into the heart of Germany. July 28th saw the culmination of prolonged bombing over the city of Hamburg and an operation codenamed Gomorrah. A combined force of 787 bombers dropped their payloads over Hamburg on that warm summer night. The conditions were perfect for a bombing run, and the bombardiers were able to put 600 incendiary devices over a 2 by 1 mile area, causing a terrifying conflagration in the city. In the densely packed districts of Hammerbrook, Ham, Borgfelde, and Rothenburgsort, a massive firestorm broke out, approximately 4.4 miles in area. Reports say an actual vortex of flames was spotted over the city, and 16,000 apartment buildings were destroyed, with 40,000 people being killed in just one night. Tragically, many of the citizens of Hamburg fled into their basements to avoid the flames, but because of the immense updraft from the firestorm, all of the oxygen was sucked out of these basements, and the people inside perished due to carbon monoxide poisoning. Two years later, in the German city of Dresden, another bombing raid would take place. In 1945, hope of victory had all but faded from the German populace, and many of them were quietly pondering which Allied power they'd rather have occupying their cities. Unless you were a secret communist, the answer was obvious: anyone but the Soviets. Rumors had long persisted that the Soviets were less than fair in their treatment of civilians. That is to say, they raped and murdered their way across formerly occupied territory. Dresdeners likely had little hope of American or British occupation by February of 1945. They were a far eastern German city, and the Soviets had already taken most of Poland and were invading Prussia. The Red Army was coming, and there was nothing the Wehrmacht could do to stop them. Please note, no one can argue that the Russians didn't have a reason to be vengeful toward the Germans for what they had done in Eastern Europe over the past several years. Two things can be inexcusable at once, and it's perilous to try to justify cruel acts for cruel acts, so nobody should try. Though the rumors of the brutality of the Red Army were to be proven true in the coming months, the Soviets were not at all what the Dresdeners had to be worried about. It was not as if the people of Dresden were not aware of Allied bombing. As mentioned before, the city of Hamburg was hit hard just 2 years earlier, and the marshalling yards in Dresden herself were bombed just months before. Despite this, there was a feeling of anonymity in the city that lured many into a false sense of security. Sure, they were a far eastern town, but the Soviets were busy in the north of Germany, and many probably thought there was no good reason for a major bombing raid against a by then mostly inert city. But those feelings would be dashed on the night of February 13th, 1945, when a force of 772 British and American planes dropped their bombs in the heart of Dresden. This kicked off a two-day raid that saw 3,900 tons of bombs dropped on the city. Of these bombs, 1,500 tons were incendiary devices, with the majority being high explosive ordnance. The hope was that the high explosives would shatter windows and blow off roofs and doors to allow increased airflow into the flames caused by the incendiaries. The Allies also employed massive bombs called bunker busters, with the hopes of rupturing main water lines to prevent firefighters from putting out the flames. This almost diabolical strategic ploy worked perfectly, and before long a massive firestorm erupted in the city. This one was nearly double the size of the one at Hamburg, coming in at 8 square miles in area. Explosion after explosion. It was beyond belief. Worse than the blackest nightmare. So many people were horribly burnt and injured. It became more and more difficult to breathe. We saw terrible things. Cremated adults shrunk to the size of small children. Pieces of arms and legs. Dead people. Whole families burnt to death. Burning people ran to and fro. Burnt coaches filled with civilian refugees. Dead rescuers and soldiers. Many were calling and looking for their children and families. And fire everywhere. Everywhere. Fire. And all the time, the hot wind of the firestorm threw people back into the burning houses they were trying to escape from. I cannot forget these terrible details. I can never forget them. Lothar Metzger, survivor. The destruction in Dresden was unfathomable. 4 square miles of the city were completely destroyed, and 25,000 lives were lost. Metzger's story shows the horrifying power of firestorms to literally pull people back into the blazes they were trying to escape. Survivor Margaret Freyer describes another harrowing scene in which a mother is fleeing from a burning building with her infant child in arms. The mother falls over and lets go of the child, who is carried into the air in an arc and pulled back into the flames. Even today, many argue the ethics and morality of the Dresden raids, with detractors citing the wanton destruction of mostly civilian targets when designating the attack a criminal massacre rather than a legitimate military operation. Allied commanders condemned the tactics used by the air forces, with lofty figures like Winston Churchill calling the bombings an act of terror. Still, others defended the raids, as Dresden was an important railroad hub and industrial center in the Eastern Reich, though many of these military targets were left unscathed, and it's even thought that the RAF pilots didn't bother taking maps of the city with them into the air, opting for an area bombing strategy rather than precision drops. Whatever the legality or morality of the attacks, the Dresden raids will likely remain the most pointed example of the awesome destructive power of firestorms. The firestorms at Dresden and Hamburg were not the only ones to form in Europe during World War II. Firestorms were also reported during the bombings of Kassel, Darmstadt, and Braunschweig in Germany, and the Nazis even managed to start a firestorm themselves in the pre-siege bombing at Stalingrad. In the Pacific Theater, the United States military surmised that an area bombing strategy would be more effective against the highly integrated industrial centers in Japan. The US Army Air Forces generally preferred a precision bombing strategy against the segregated industrial targets in Europe, and this was very effective in Germany. But in Japan, the industrial targets were often mixed in with civilian buildings, making it nearly impossible to distinguish them from the air. For this reason, General Curtis LeMay, later of Strategic Air Command fame, adopted a strategy of carpet bombing Japanese cities. The horrible effects of firebombing were bad enough in Germany, but in Japan, most of the buildings were made of wood, and even paper was a common feature of Japanese architecture. That, mixed with a very high population density, made Japanese cities uniquely susceptible to firebomb attack. Nowhere is this point better proven than in the case of the Tokyo firebombing raids of March 1945, when 279 B-29 bombers dropped 1,500 tons of bombs over the city. Almost 16 square miles of Tokyo were burned, and nearly 100,000 people were killed, with a further 40,000 being wounded. Though many historians speculate that these numbers are too low, as Tokyo had the highest population density of any modern city at the time. Though it must be stated that mass migration into and out of Tokyo makes it impossible to know the exact numbers, though once you get past 10,000 civilians, it does little to change the gravity of the event. Surprisingly enough, no actual firestorm was ever reported in Tokyo due to a high prevailing surface wind, though this wind did have the effect of fanning the flames and spreading the fires throughout the city. The Tokyo firebombing still stands today as the costliest air raid in human history, even more so than the forthcoming atomic bombings at Hiroshima and Nagasaki. There were firestorms reported in Japan during World War II, specifically at Ube and, unsurprisingly, at Hiroshima. It seems obvious that in the wake of an event that caused temperatures in excess of 4,000 degrees Celsius that a firestorm would have surely erupted, and though it was enormous, it wasn't particularly destructive or deadly. This is mostly because it was firmly situated inside the already obliterated blast radius of the bomb. Oof, that was heavy. Now time for something lighter.
You in Vietnam, bitches!
Yes, you might assume that in the war that has become so heavily associated with napalm that firestorms would have just been a part of life. Only they weren't. But this wasn't due to lack of trying. After all, this was the war of death from above, where the United States military dropped more bombs on Vietnam than all the nations combined during World War II. This was also the war of, they're in the trees, man! So naturally, the Air Force was very interested in destroying the Viet Cong's most effective weapon, the jungle.
They're not just in the jungle, they are the jungle.
Codename, Operation Sherwood Forest. This was the plan. First, they needed a worthwhile target, say a forest full of Viet Cong. Boi Loi Forest was only 25 miles away from Saigon and was positively brimming with VCs. Perfect. Next, the Air Force would begin a week-long mission to defoliate Boi Loi with herbicide. Lots of herbicide. They would drop 78,000 gallons of the stuff over the forest with the hopes that the dry foliage would help to ignite the normally moist jungle. Finally, a force of B-52s would drop their payloads made up of M-34 cluster bombs, each packing 57 individual incendiary devices. The weather had been dry for the past 4 days and things were looking up. The planes took off on March 3rd but were abruptly called back because... thunderstorms. Tough luck. The operation went forward 8 days later, but it didn't work. There was fire, sure, but no firestorms. Must have been the rain. So, they tried again. Codename Operation Hot Tip. Just like last time, step one was to spray herbicide over their new target, the Chupang Mountain area. And this time, they would use the totally safe, would never cause horrifying birth defects, Agent Orange. 22,000 gallons of the wonderful chemical, to be exact. Again, they waited a few days for defoliation and then launched the B-52s. Over two separate missions, the Air Force dropped 172 tons of bombs over the Chupang Mountain area, sat back, and waited for the firestorms to churn. That didn't work either. The operation was technically perfect in every way, only they couldn't produce a firestorm. They had to be frustrated by now, but they decided to give it one more go. Codename Operation Inferno. With a name like that, it had to work. The whole defoliant cluster bomb thing didn't seem to be working, so they decided to change it up a bit. The new target was the U Minh Forest, a Viet Cong base southwest of Saigon, only this time they didn't bother with killing the foliage. Instead, they decided to drop 55-gallon drums of fuel oil out the backs of C-130s. 14 C-130s flew a snaking pattern over U Minh, dropping 65 drums of oil, each with incendiary grenades strapped to them for detonation. Conditions were nominal, and everything went off without a hitch, only no firestorms. They tried one more time in 1968, but still no success. Many speculate that the wet conditions in the Vietnamese jungle made it impossible for a firestorm to happen. And that leaves us here in 2022. Since 1983, Geneva Convention Protocol restricts the use of incendiary weapons against civilian targets or against military targets in the near vicinity of civilians. This protocol was no doubt influenced by the horrifying firestorms of World War II and the proliferous use of napalm in the Vietnam War. So as far as international law is concerned, firestorms should no longer be a worry. But the Geneva Convention is only effective if everybody plays nice, and there's no real obstacle stopping even third-world countries from employing incendiary bombs. That's not even mentioning the staggering number of nuclear weapons in the world, 6 of which are confirmed missing from the United States arsenal, though that's a story for another video. So the question is, could we see a firestorm in the brave new world of the 21st century? The short answer is yes, of course we could, if the conditions were right. But the longer, more hopeful answer is not likely. It is thought that the material makeup of the modern cityscape is not conducive to firestorm formation. Cities in the 1940s were still largely made of wood, but today it's mostly concrete, steel, and glass, though the fast-burning nature of modern homes makes the prospect of a firebombed neighborhood particularly frightening. So firestorms are not impossible in the 21st century, especially when we remember that forest fires happen every year with disturbing regularity. We all hope to never see bombings on the scale of Dresden or Hamburg in our lifetimes, but unfortunately, modern militaries have never been more capable of waging such a war. Fire is still the ultimate destroyer, and mankind will likely continue to utilize it as a weapon for as long as we wage war with each other. But hey, it's not as if anybody's been talking about World War III lately, right? Right?
Suggesting Western arms shipments to Kyiv are a sign NATO is in essence engaged in a proxy war with Russia. Sergei Lavrov warning the risk of the conflict escalating to nuclear war is real.
A Ukrainian official said the attack killed at least 10 people, injured dozens of others.
We rallied our alliances to meet both the direct threats of Russia poses to Europe and the systemic challenges that China poses to a rules-based world order. And we've invited 2 new members to join NATO, Finland and Sweden.
And says the decision to do so would prompt Russia to reinforce its borders, possibly with nuclear weapons.
They will be met with fire and fury like the world has never seen.
No one should underestimate the determination and ability of more than 1.4 billion Chinese people to defend its national sovereignty and territorial integrity. I hope the country concerned will see this clearly and not play with fire.
Are you willing to get involved militarily to defend Taiwan if it comes to that?
Yes.
We must either love each other or we must die.